If there is one thing that characterizes leaders in the IT industry, it is versatility. And no one can be more versatile than Dr. Mohan Reddy. Mohan has been a technical guru in our country and went on to create a billion-dollar enterprise, Infotech, later known as Cyient. Cyient was a pioneer in geographical information systems and created the brand Engineered in India. Mohan has gone on to become chairman of NASSCOM, worked in multiple capacities in NASSCOM with the local governments in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, and in education for both the center and the states, and was justly awarded the Padma Shri by the President of India. A very approachable gentleman and a thoroughly nice person, Mohan Reddy is one of the industry stars.
Well, hello again, and here we are with Mr. Mohan Reddy, who is actually one of the doyens of our industry, because he has been in various aspects of the industry for many, many years. And I first had the privilege to meet him when he was running his previous company. And then, of course, we've been partners for many, many years in NASSCOM, doing wonderful things together. So Mohan, absolute privilege to have you with us on this show. And can we start by just getting a little background? Who is Mohan Reddy and how should we know you by?
Thank you, Ganesh. Thank you very much for having me on this show. It's always a pleasure seeing you, though in the virtual world now, having a conversation with you. Let me briefly tell you where I come from. I was born in the middle class family. My father was a senior police officer with the state, and my mother was a homemaker. We're four siblings, And the middle class dream I keep saying about the 1960s people was to make sure that the children were educated, and that was the safety net they built. They gave the best of education to the children, and that's what my parents did. And those were the days when actually two professions used to get the best of recognition. One was a medical doctor and the other was an engineer. So my mother decided that the girl cannot be an engineer. So my sister became a doctor. She's a medical doctor. And she decided I should become an engineer. So that's how I started to become an engineer too. And we grew together in an environment which was embodiment to us of values. That's what I carried through all my life. I went to different schools in many parts of Andhra Pradesh, the old state. Finally went to an engineering college in a town called Kakinada. That was one of the oldest engineering colleges in the country. It was an engineering college which was started off with the British. A great school to be in, and I did my undergrad in mechanical engineering. And thereafter, my passion for education did not stop. Therefore, I went to IIT Kanpur. I got my first master's. And thereafter, worked for a couple of years before I went and got my second master's from University of Michigan. Somehow, from my early days, my passion was more on mechanical engineering. I keep relating the biggest mechanical engineering device I used to see in my childhood days was a road roller on the streets of India. Huge, 5 tons in weight. Initially, it was steam. Thereafter, it was diesel. But they used to roll around, basically trying to lay roads in those good old days. And it was a very nice experience to tell people that, you know, look, I want to build those road rollers. That's what I used to say very early in my life. That passion continued. That's how I became a mechanical engineer. My first encounter with computers was in IIT Kanpur. In 1971, by a strange coincidence, it happens to be 50 years since I first worked on a computer. IIT Kanpur in those days had the best of the computer centers in India, the largest of computer centers in India. And I had the privilege of writing Fortran programming those days and wrote my master's thesis. So in a way, you can describe me as a middle-class Mohan Reddy has passion for education. Learned several things in life before he became an entrepreneur.
But tell me how you started and what was your first entrepreneurial stint? I mean, did you start off in mechanical engineering, and has that been a theme for your life?
Yes and no, Ganesh. My first job actually was as a senior management trainee with the DCM group. They had a company called Shriram Refrigeration those days. So therefore I took that role, and the job they gave me was that I used to run a diesel engine assembly shop. I used to be the production manager, whatever it was. And so therefore my first role in life was on a mechanical engineering device called diesel engine, assembling them. And you know, working with about 250 of shop floor workers, including the lowest of lowest skills in terms of packing those diesel engines, three shift operation. Great learnings in life. Primarily I learned all about how to manage a workforce, how to run operations. Those were the days and times when computers were never present anywhere around in the corporate world. So we used to run everything with paper, do a bill of material explosion, thereafter get to the stores every weekend to make sure parts are indented for the following week. And if there are shortfalls, we used to, people like me used to make sure you took a train to our one of the suppliers. The biggest suppliers were all in this place called Kolhapur, which is about 10 hours of train ride from Hyderabad. Go collect the parts over the weekend. We didn't stop our assembly line. And that's what I keep describing people as what I keep saying is owner's mindset. I didn't own that company, but I did wanted to make sure as a trainee too, not to stop the assembly line. That was my first role in life. Thereafter, I went to US and came back. My liking intensity for computers increased. So when I came back from US, I was also one of those rare people who came back from US in the 1970s. I had some commitments back at home. My father wasn't too well. I made a commitment, I'll come back. And that's one of the greatest satisfactions I have in life, keeping up a word. I told my father, irrespective of what happens, I'll come back. And I came back after my master's. I came back and took a role in Myco Bosch. That's when it used to be called, as now it's called just Bosch, I guess. And my role there was a systems analyst. That was the first time I was working in a company on computers. It was IBM 1401. It was called Electronic Data Processing. The input was using cards. There used to be punch cards, both card punchers as well as verifiers. And I used to do the system design work. I spent about 2 years. I learned a little better about computers. I learned this computing language called AutoCoder. Many people might not have heard, but I think I used to enjoy really because it used to be so close to the machine. When the program used to run on the machine, you could stop the machine momentarily, change the code and allow it to run it from that point of that point onwards. You had an enormous amount of closeness to the machine. You understood the internals of machine at that point of time. That was about 2.5 years. Certainly there was a keen intent of becoming an entrepreneur at some point of time. And I needed to fully complete my experience. I had operations, I had computers. What I was lacking was selling. So I found an interesting company, an interesting set of individuals, some of whom you must have interacted with too. And this was HCL, or those days it was called Hindustan Computers Limited. They gave me a role as a sales manager, and I took the role. I did well. I spent 2 years with them. So by the end of about after my first master's degree, I spent about 6-7 years with the industry. So while I wanted to become an entrepreneur again more seriously, a good-natured senior Indian administrative officer came to me and said, you seem to have a lot of appetite with you, Mohan, but I think still you lack two things. I said, what? You don't have enough money with you, which was very true. And those are the times that money was also important. And the second one, he said, you don't have the technology with you. So he said there was yet another opportunity, which he said he'll introduce me to. And that was people with money was Tata's, and people with technology was this outstanding computer scientist who lived in the United States, continues to live in the United States, a gentleman called Dr. Raj Reddy. So we joined hands together and started a company called OMC Computers. This was in 1982. That was when computers were very new in this country. There were largely four companies which dominated the Indian marketplace: HCL, DCM, ORG, and there was this public sector company called ECIL. But all of them were targeting towards commercial data processing, whether it was multi-terminal commercial data processing machines or a single user machines that they had with them. But all of them were doing more amount of commercial work, which is to do with, say, accounting, payroll, inventory control, and so on and so forth. So when this opportunity came up and I took on the role of being the founder president as well as the managing director of the company, when the issue of product positioning came in, I could marry my dreams of having that passion for mechanical engineering and the new learnings on computers. So we positioned our product to be addressing the computer-aided design, computer-aided manufacturing, and computer-aided engineering markets, as they're popularly called as CAD, CAM, CAE. That's what the market is.
Was that almost the first company doing CAD, CAM, CAE, OMC?
It is the first company, Ganesh. People never heard about CAD, CAM in this country. Very honestly, as a frontline salesman too, people used to ask me for the expansion of this word called CAD. It was as difficult as that. So it was a challenge of not market share, but a challenge in terms of market development. Certainly a very challenging environment at that point of time. Still, there used to be a fairly large number of restrictions in terms of import of some of the components. The Government of India rule at that point of time was more of local assembly, but then local assembly from component level. So therefore, it was extremely difficult job in terms of putting together those machines. And none of the peripherals which were used for CAD, CAM, CAE, like plotters, scanners, were available in India. They had to be imported in the fully assembled stage. But we found a good niche for ourselves. Over a period of time, introduced several more products. One of them was actually a PC itself, which was a higher end. We further souped it up with a couple of more peripherals and a locally developed software for drafting and modeling applications. It was actually, the name of the product itself was called Draftsman. So my first foray into this area of computer design, engineering, and manufacturing was through OMC Computers. And that was in 1982. I spent 10 full years with them by the time I left the company, all right. But then a year before I really left the company, I started getting these ideas back again, saying that, you know, look, ambition in life was to become an entrepreneur. And the time is running out on me. I was turning 40. That was another data point that I had. And I said, if I don't do it now, I'll never do it in my life. And added to that,
you know, you were almost an entrepreneur. You were you came in as the CEO. So you must have been a part owner of the company, I guess.
Yes, I was a part owner of the company, Ganesh. And I had about 4% of the company when I left them. And I used to report into a gentleman called Mr. H. Tobaccowala. He was a director on the board of Tata Sons. And HT gave me a very generous exit for me when I left. And that was the seed money that I used for starting up the then company that was Infotech Enterprises, which was rebranded as Cyient.
So when you started Infotech, Mohan, what was your, was there going to be a core focus or was it going to be primarily just engineering services?
I think for sure the focus was to build an engineering services company. Engineering was our core competence that I had with me, and that was my passion in life. And equally important, it's not just the passion or the competence, is the there was very clearly an addressable market, which is humongously large. There was rest of the players, if you saw in 1991, 92, when already the information technology companies, the respected names like Infosys, TCS, Wipro, HCL, all were in play. But all of them back again were largely focusing towards IT services, IT outsourcing services. Interestingly, what happened, Ganesh, is the last year I was in OMC Computers, in order to have a perfect handshake with my successor, who was then the executive director of the company, I also decided to step off from the operations and do exports. So I also had the a better understanding of the global markets as I started handling exports for OMC Computers, especially the US marketplace. We did get a big breakthrough. I mentioned about our 2D drafting product, and this was then being marketed in US itself through a partner. So therefore, what happened is at the end of 91, I finally got out of OMC. I registered my company. And 92, 93 was my first financial year in Infotech Enterprises. But the large objective, all, of course, was to build engineering services. Our competence was in engineering. To build a global leader, build a brand called Engineered in India. That was the ambition with which Infotech Enterprises was started.
So tell me a little bit about Infotech. I mean, over the last two decades plus, what have you... Has the company morphed at all? I mean, I know you were doing geographical information systems, engineering, aerospace. So, I mean, from an industry point of view and specifically from science point of view, I mean, what were the learnings on the way in terms of what do people really want to do as engineer from India? And did you make some mistakes?
Yes. Thank you, Ganesh, for prompting me. Ganesh, if you we started off with this ambition saying that, you know, let's do outsourcing of engineering services from India, like outsourcing of IT services. We somehow realized as we got into it that people were very reluctant to give engineering as outsourcing. As I keep saying, what do companies do? They develop their products. And what are products? Products are crown jewels of companies. So you can't go ahead and give them out to somebody else for outsourcing. And these were also early days for India. People had a lot of hesitancy in terms of whether my IP will be protected, whether there were competent people back in India. So there's fairly large amount of reluctance that was there. If at all, one service offering which was readily accessible was drafting, which is basically taking the age-old paper drawings and convert them into digital format. We talk about digital transformation. In many of these areas, digital transformation to the extent of converting from paper-based information to digital information started way back in 92. But that was actually not a very lucrative market because people could not find many users if you probably just converted an old drawing, which was in paper, into a digital format. Because new products were coming, new products were anyway in the digital format. If you look at a drawing, actually a drawing gets used by subsequently a few people. A company has probably a set of engineers who make it, a set of engineers who then, who design it and then who probably manufacture it. So therefore, application of the digital content was not so much intense at that point of time. So we found an adjacency where if you create a digital information once, it could be used by millions of people. And that was basically geographic information systems. Maps could, they have an extremely strong commonality with drawings. I keep saying the ingenuity of human mind is you draw two lines on a piece of paper and then say to an engineer, this is a drawing. That guy says, this is it is a cross section of a shaft. Whereas you show the same thing to a, say, no, this is not a drawing. This is a map. What do you think of these two lines? He says, that's a road. That's how you depict on it. So they're very, very close to each other. So the elements that build a map or a drawing are the same. The elements called line, spline, circle, annotation, and so on and so forth. So we found that to be a very interesting market, fairly large addressable market. And especially at that point of time, a number of telecom companies and power utility companies were migrating from paper-based information into digital format. So they wanted all their assets to be mapped, because if you see these two segments or two industries, telecom and power utilities, power distribution utilities, you find that their assets are not in one location, they're spread all over. So they wanted to know the asset positioning. So therefore, you know, they could do a number of things, plan expansion, or when it comes to maintenance, how quickly can I go? They knew which was the transformer which blew up, which is the crew that had to go by, because all that information was digital and available to them online. So what we found was that for about 7 years, we did largely GIS, but we also grew very well. We systematically put in place, because this was very manual, manual intensive work that it was. There was no automation that was possible with technologies at that point of time. Technologies have considerably changed now, but the need for converting paper-based information to digital format doesn't exist any longer, because that is already past. So therefore, we had to focus ourselves in terms of making sure we had processes in place to see that the quality was consistent all the time. Our motto was the best of quality over and over again, on-time delivery at an affordable price. And that commitment was kept. And to the extent that some of our customers used to get very surprised, the type of quality we could produce for them, that was largely driven by one thing called process. But in 1999, 2000, we got a major breakthrough. The first time that we continue to pursue our ambition of becoming an engineering services company. We continue to work on it in the background. And we got a big breakthrough. We ran into this company by an accident. It was called Pratt & Whitney, which is a division of United Technology Corporation, which currently is called Raytheon Technologies. It has morphed itself into acquisitions and mergers and so on and so forth. And so the first time we got a foray was into engineering services, was into aerospace industry, very new to us. And I think the key driver for that was the customer had great admiration and appreciation for our processes. And as he would say when we interviewed him much later, he said what he liked about us was our ability to articulate everything that we had with us at that point of time. So he said trust played a very important role. We trusted what you told us, and we delivered to the promises we made to the customer. It's an amazing relationship that we had with Pratt & Whitney. It continues to be a great account in spite of the challenges that we've had in the recent past with the pandemic, with the airline industry having had serious challenges. And a reflection of, I think, Indian companies' ability to delight the customer and make sure that we created an enormous amount of value of customers was the size of our company could create an account of account which is more than $100 million. In just United Technology Corporation itself. UTC was a $125 million account in 2019 for us.
So if you take a $100 million account like Pratt & Whitney or UTC, what does it do? I mean, can you just describe to us, I mean, you mentioned drafting and CAD/CAM and GIS. So what else is there in the engineering services basket?
So over a period of time, the engineering marketplace has also matured itself. At a very early stages, this industry, like the IT services, also was more in terms of body shopping. They required some skilled engineers. Not that we were very intense on it, but you know, there could have been one or two small engagements that we had. But thereafter, it became more in terms of our ability to project manage these projects. So therefore, it was fixed price outsourcing projects that came in. And thereafter, the customers started, as the relationships matured, went into different types of business models. But in terms of the type of work that was done, is initially they could be asking us just to do a piece of work in a particular component. For example, you take a aircraft engine. Aircraft engine hangs from the wing. There is a flange through which they couple the engine with the aircraft wing. That flange had to be designed, for example. that design of the flange that requires stress, strain, how much of load that comes in, and so on and so forth. So use different tools to simulate different types of conditions to design that flange. I'm giving you as simple an example as that. That could be a very simple example. But over a period of time, for example, if you see the relationship with Pratt & Whitney, Pratt & Whitney in 2011 or 12 decided to build a brand new engine called the GTF engine, geared turbofan engine. Primarily, the feature of that engine was putting a gearbox into an aircraft engine. For the first time, any aircraft engine manufacturer was doing that. And the novelty with this engine was that instead of shaft of the aircraft engine in one running in one single speed, it could run at multiple speeds. Enormous amount of advantage it would give. One is the sound was coming down, and then the fuel efficiency was higher, and then the carbon footprint was coming further down. So they enlisted us for doing this project along with them. And at the end of it, in the complete engine design itself, which is to give you a flavor, typically an engine design in billions of dollars, what it costs for a brand new engine. And we participated to the extent of about 22% of the design work was done by us. And more importantly, about 25% of innovation in this particular engine was credited to our engineers. We don't hold the IP, but in the IPs, our names of our engineers would appear. So if you look at what have we contributed is innovation and also the effort, both of them, in building a brand new engine, which was probably very revolutionary. It is very, very gratifying to see Indian engineers participate in a brand new engine design.
No, but actually, Mohan, that is amazing because listening to you, I mean, your depth of understanding of what was the new engine, the whole, you know, putting a gearbox into an aircraft for the first time, carbon footprint. I mean, it kind of shows where we have evolved from just maybe shipping off programmers abroad and maybe doing it offshore, really understanding what it takes to build very, very high-end products. So in a sense, I mean, when we've talked about the industry and talked about IT, talked about IT services to BPO, to what we're talking about now, would you say this is literally the high end of capability that India is demonstrating and taking to the world, the whole engineering services game?
Yes and no, Ganesh. Thank you very much for acknowledging the type of work we've done. But very honestly, Ganesh, what I've explained to you is a very small bit or the tip of the iceberg. Actually, it's very complex in terms of the heat sections. The amount of heat that gets produced, it goes to about 2000 degrees inside the aircraft engine. Handling all that is enormous amount of technology. Certainly, yes, but not necessarily all the work we do is this engine related work. But the type of challenges that are there thereafter in terms of manufacturing them becomes another issue by itself. So we participated in manufacturing engineering. Because these are not products which can be replaced immediately. They have to be repaired in many instances if there are minor faults or defects that come by. And as a result of that, it's a whole cycle of what the product lifecycle management, as it's called, or PLM, that goes through. You start from an initial concept, you get into a design, you engineer it, you get it manufactured, you support it. It's from cradle to the grave. That's the cycle that we can take through. So in a way, you're right. Some of the work that we do certainly is very leading edge technology work.
So in the world of Industry 4.0, smart manufacturing, simulating complete production lines with digital twinning before you actually physically do it. So are these the kind of demands on engineering services companies that you're getting from your clients?
Yes. Good question, Ganesh. These are the demands that we are getting from our customers at this point of time. And there are a number of examples where we have created a digital twin of an offshore oil rigging platform north of Ireland, and where it is excruciatingly difficult for people to even live on the platform. It's so cold. And from that, we now have reduced the amount of manpower that's there on the offshore platform to an extent of about 50%, I believe. Because the digital twin is there, you can now manage to see what's happening on the platform at this point of time. Or if there's a failure that's likely to happen, you could predict it much more. Certainly, I think the Industry 4.0 applications are many right now, and to give a flavor, and it really even is fascinating for people like me, the amount of progress people are seeing. The five senses that human being has are now being replicated with the computers too. They can see them very well, the visual computing, I'm sure everybody is familiar with, or we can touch it, we can feel the vibrations, the heat, the temperature, all that is going on. But interestingly, they are hearing, and they can also smell and taste. Those two things, not many applications, I can give you a few, but I think the hearing is the one which is also very exciting these days, because most of the machinery makes noise. It's not silent. Even an aircraft engine makes some noise. But from the noise, you can start making out, synthesizing, if there is a failure of a part or a potential failure of a part anywhere in particular engine system or a power plant. Actually, there's a great application of a consumer, high volume consumer product conveyor belt, which is now being using sensors, which are basically hearing sensors. Even if there's one bearing which is faulty on a conveyor line, which has thousands of bearings on them, you can isolate it very quickly. So you're not stopping. Yes, yes. So therefore, there are a number of applications that are coming in, and not only applications of this nature, but you know, there are in healthcare, for instance, there are a fairly large number of product design opportunities. And along with the product design opportunities are opportunities which come with data analytics, application of AI. And what we're seeing is much further fascinating in the sense that we have not worked in areas like agriculture, for instance, and you now find technology being used there, and you require domain expertise of agriculture. You fly a drone at this point of time. Originally, the intent was when we did a proof of concept to one of our customers, we were saying, you know, we'll try to see how pest is there on the agricultural field for us to use the pesticide. But after getting the imagery, what we found was we could get 64 characteristics of the crop and the soil from that imagery. So therefore, it's not just you're looking for pest, you can look for many more things from the same image. There's no different from that. And thereafter, you apply your AI algorithms on top of it. You're doing forecasting of what type of crop, what type of yield, when will the yield come, all of these. So there are many exciting applications we are seeing through the Industry 4.0.
Well, that's a very interesting point you're making, Mohan, because you're saying that engineering services competence, it goes way beyond the engineering industry itself and could be healthcare, could be agriculture and all the other sectors of the economy which can get impacted. That's very, very interesting. Okay, let me swing to the last segment of this interview, which is, I mean, we've both been part of NASSCOM. We've both seen the $190 billion industry evolve. And as we know, it's gone through various phases. What is the size of your segment? I mean, if you look at engineering services, I mean, including GIS and everything else that may not be that popular today, how much of the 200 billion is just engineering services represent, and how many significant companies, third party companies like yourselves, are there in this field?
Sure. Ganesh, the NASSCOM published data itself shows that out of the $200 billion pie, approximately about $30 billion of it is ER&D services. They call it as engineering and R&D services. There is one caveat I should say, the ER&D services as being defined by NASSCOM also includes software product development, but that's also engineering. You know, it's not hardware, but software associated with it. So that is the size of the market right now. That's about $30 billion of industry that we created in ER&D. There are two parts to the players that are there. One is that there are easier one to first start with is that several multinationals have found India to be a great destination for doing engineering and created what are called as the GISs, Global Innovation Centers. There are as many as 1,000 of them in India right now. 1,000 GISs are there in engineering R&D. Whether it is the largest of large companies like GE's or a few startups that are doing their products in India, they're there. So therefore, the India-centric or India-based companies that have come into play, there are two parts to it. One is there are large IT companies too, which do engineering. And the other one is there are companies which only do generic engineering services. In the IT, large IT services, you'll find all the suspects, which are whether it is Wipro, which does a lot of telecom embedded software and so on and so forth, or Infosys does a lot of aerospace work, and HCL, because of an acquisition that they did of an engineering services company, have a large bulk. But in the pure play engineering services market, we identify about three players who are there. L&T is one of them. There's another privately held company called Quest, and we are the other third player. These are three significant players. When I say significant, they're probably between $500 million to $750 million in terms of revenue.
So if I were to slice and dice the 30 billion, you're saying that about 2 billion is by third party, and about 9, 10 billion would be software products. And maybe the captives and the large companies together would be contributing the other maybe 18, 19 billion.
Other way of looking at it is that these three companies, which I said, which were pure play engineering services companies, but there could be another 300 of them, which are smaller in size. I've not called out those names. I only called out the three names, which are significant in terms of size. So
they need to get the another 2 billion.
Yes, yes. It's much beyond the 2 billion that is there with these people. And so therefore, I think it's very difficult. We have not still seen an analysis of how much is from each one of them. And as I said, there is some amount of grayness in terms of how do we segregate them. For example, software testing is also considered to be ER&D services. It's R&D, you build a product, you're now testing the product and so on and so forth. But more importantly, leaving that apart, $30 billion in the universe, which says ER&D services. And we think there is a significant upside to capture as we move forward. It is morphing to be different in different forms. I'll give you two or three different flavors of it, Ganesh, very briefly. One is that this was pure engineering services play that was there. And from thereafter, it is becoming more of a subsystem design play. The people don't care about, you know, what engineering you do, but they give you specs for saying this is a black box that you need to design and give it back to us. This is the input and this is the output, and you got to completely design it, test it, and give it back to them. A good example is there is BPCU. It's called bus power control unit in an aircraft. Primarily, it controls all the voltages in an aircraft. Because you would have realized, you know, if you apply yourself, you'll realize that you know we consume so many different types of devices on an aircraft too. There is heating ovens in the galley. There's air conditioning going on. You also have the video display units and so on and so forth. So the result is there is an enormous amount of power electronics that's there in an aircraft itself. So one of the OEMs wanted us to design a black box where number of different inputs that come in and outputs that are required. It's a line replaceable unit. You know, you just take out the box and push back a new box in case there's a faultiness in it. So that is the subsystem level design. Whereas at next level is actually a solution provider. People are coming back to us and saying, can you design a product for us? These products could be in, say, a radar detection equipment. It's a complete product design that we are doing for customers. So that is one progression that we have seen, services to subsystems to solutions. And the second one is that we're also seeing, and some of the players are into it, is that customers are saying, look, you know, we don't want just the design or engineering part. We want the physical product finally. So you want, they physically spec out a physical product that's there. And it could be a bedside health monitoring system. And you got to design it, you got to engineer it, manufacture it, prototype it, and finally manufacture them for on large scale to supply, ship it to the customer, which we do at this point of time. So our ability to design, as we keep saying, gives us a right to play in the manufacturing market too. So therefore, it's not that you just take specifications, but you know, you take the product itself and you build the product for the customer. So that's another play that's the growth we're
seeing. That's interesting. I remember you telling me this about 3 years back. So you're saying that manufacturing to scale is actually a significant portion of the work you do?
Not significant, significant because, you know, it's about 10% of our revenue comes from manufacturing, if you say manufacturing as
such. But it's full life cycle when you do that.
And it's also growing quite rapidly.
Okay.
Yeah, that's yet another thing that we're seeing. And these are, as we see, it's not built to print. Somebody gives us the drawings and say, just manufacture this. No, that's all disappeared from us. It's built to spec. Somebody gives you a spec saying, this is the product I need. Can you design, engineer, manufacture, give it back to us? We are in a position to do it.
That's amazing, Mohan. And my last question is that, I mean, this morning I was on the advisory board of an engineering college, and they were lamenting that, you know, there's no demand for mechanical and electrical engineers, and should we train everybody for IT? And I was trying to caution them that IT engineers may not necessarily get that great job in the future because jobs are changing. But essentially what you're saying is that if you really look at the engineering services market and the kind of work that you're talking about, there's a huge need for extremely well-qualified design engineers, manufacturing engineers, especially with Atmanirbhar and this whole movement of India towards much more manufacturing. So would you advise engineers to stay in engineering and not kind of run away and try to do other stuff?
Yes, certainly yes. Right now, Ganesh, what we're also seeing is that there's, of course, the engineering has changed quite a bit. A very classic example of mine is automobile engineering, for instance. The largest piece of equipment inside an automobile was something called an IC engine, internal combustion engine. That has disappeared in EV at this point of time. So therefore, there is a fairly large amount of interdisciplinary requirements that have come in. I work with a number of education institutions. I work with Ministry of Education at this point of time. What we're trying to impress on them is the multidisciplinary nature that's come by. So if an automobile has, I mean, you're as good as me, if not better than me, it has electronics, it has embedded software, it has LiDAR, it has many other technologies built into it. So therefore, it can't be just saying mechanical engineer means I would just understand what physical parts are and do the mechanical engineering part of it is not going to work for sure. But I think there is enormous amount of opportunity ahead of times. Take example of, you know, drones, for instance. Drones, again, is a good example. Type of applications are in different sectors, but it has aerodynamics on it. It has electronics on it. It has got software built into it. All of them go into one single product. So engineering has tremendous amount of opportunity ahead.
So one final last question. So if you really project the industry forward, I mean, we all know that the $1 trillion Digital India will hopefully, this $190 billion will become maybe $350, $375 billion. So if this industry doubles, do you think the composition of the industry will change substantially between IT, BPO, products, and let's say engineering services? There will be something will gain more prominence in future in the next 2-3 years.
I wouldn't say that something will gain prominence, Ganesh, but what will happen is the so-called thick lines between say IT, BPO, or engineering, etc., will start disappearing. You will see in engineering, for instance, if you're doing a product development, there's a fairly large amount of software also that's coming back to us. So therefore, you know, are we therefore moving into software? No, but it's a part of it. So therefore, I think what we will see is applications which will have many ingredients associated with them. And we can't say that, you know, one would disappear, but common threads across all of them is a tremendous amount of digital transformation that's happening. Every product is becoming digital. The second one is a fairly large amount of automation that's happening. Low-end work, even in terms of drafting, has completely disappeared. You know, you can write routines which can create those drawings for us from a 3D model, for example. So therefore, those trends are very true. Digitization, automation, innovation. Three themes that I like to emphasize on. But otherwise, I think, you know, the silos will also disappear. There'll be some amount of trespassing from one to the other, but that's all part of the evolution process.
So all in all, we can say that it's going to be an exciting future. It's been
Absolutely.
An exciting
future. That is no denying at all. That is 100% sure.
Thank you, Mohan. It was great talking to you. And I think we really covered a lot of ground. So thank you so much for being
Thank you, Ganesh. Thank you very much. I appreciate you giving me this opportunity to me. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks.